Amen. Why don't we put our hands together as we welcome our mama to come and speak to us the word of God. Let's work together in a glorious way in Jesus' name. Amen.
We also be in the house. We miss a choir like we have had the place of worship. We would only see them sing. But we don't know that we can see them, we can hear them, we are blessed together. Yesterday was my birthday. Amen. Thank you for wishing me a happy birthday. For those who wrote on my WhatsApp, I really appreciate it. It was a great day for me. Even this day, as I start another year, I count it a blessing from the Lord to start another year, because I was a bit afraid at first when we are being told that this number of years should not come to church. I see that my ears are getting close, so that I'm closed out from the church. But thank God that we have been added more years, and God is still adding years to my life. And I believe God will give me more to serve. Praise the Lord. And as I was receiving many messages, there's a group that of women we used to study together in high school more than 40 years back. And there used to be so many messages on our WhatsApp group. Many, many of them, it's a habit of us to do so, wishing one another a happy birthday. There is one of us who coordinates that. We will see a very good picture, and they get a picture of whoever has the birthday, and so many comment that. And one thing that I rejoiced of all the comments that they made was that all of them, or most of them, were wishing me a very good time to serve the Lord. Though they know me as a servant of God. And whenever we have meetings, I pray for them, we fellowship together, I give them the word, and anything spiritual, they normally give me that opportunity to serve them. So as they wished me many more years to serve. You know, I had a lot to thank God for. Telling God, for sure, I want to serve you more than ever before. And in fact, this year has been a very, very good year for me. It is bad with the corona and outside there, but health-wise, I have seen the heart of God, and I really praise Him. Again, my family celebrated me in the evening. We had a good celebration. And they also wished me very, very good words. I felt like I want to live many, many, many more years to be hearing such words. God bless you, may He do good to you. So coming to our word of neighboring well, we have had two Sundays hearing about neighboring well. And I want to believe that all of us have been challenged to be better neighbors. In the last or in the last Sunday, remember Pastor Peter talked to us about neighboring well through loving God, loving ourselves, and loving our neighbors. And our Reverend Felix talked about loving neighbors by doing to others what we would expect them to do to us. It was a great challenge to some of us. As we could continue fellowshiping in the course of the week, whereby we were learning more and more, getting deeper into that, and asking ourselves what we expect our neighbors to do to us. And then we ask ourselves, then what are we supposed to do in return? And I believe that it was a challenge that we have taken positively, that we may continue serving one another. So today, I want to talk about neighboring well through compassion. And compassion is or involves serving others. It involves walking the talk, not just talking. Many times we talk more than we do. And as the Bible admonishes us that we should be quick, or we should practice the word, we should do as the word tells us. We should not only be hearers, but doers. So when we hear the word of God, it is always a blessing to put it into practice. And that is why we receive more blessings when we do so. And as I was trying to think of who a neighbor is, I came across this description of a neighbor, meaning that a neighbor is anyone in need. And I want to believe that at one time or the other, you needed someone. I don't think there is anybody who would say that you have never needed somebody at one point or the other. If you are there and you have never been in need, you must be very special. Even those people who have a lot, and you may look at them and think that they don't have needs, just know that they have more needs maybe than you think they have. Because needs are not just material things. There are many kinds of needs. There are those that just need a friend. They are those who just need somebody to talk to them. They may not need any of your material things, but they just need you to be there for them. Well, as I looked at being a neighbor, the meaning of being a neighbor then, since we understand that a neighbor is that one who has need, then being a neighbor therefore is looking for opportunities to help someone in need. Getting that opportunity that you can help another person is being a neighbor. And we are not just talking of being a neighbor, but we are talking of being a good neighbor. Neighboring well. Taking another step to neighbor well with the others. And I was realizing that good neighbors or neighborliness comes in when there are those people who are willing to help and there are those who have the needs. So they meet at a certain point and then the neighboring becomes quite well. I also realized that as I was thinking, I realized that there are some areas where neighboring well is really practiced. And I was comparing the rural areas and the urban areas. And I realized that at times in urban areas, like our setting here in Nairobi, there are times that you don't even know what happens in the next door of your neighbor. You just get into your house, you are concerned about your own things. At times you don't even get to know your neighbors. You only get to know them when they have needs. Maybe when they have a problem, you will get to know them. But when you go to the rural areas, you realize that people didn't know one another. They face it freely. Like the village I came from, or where I was born, and I grew in my early days. I remember that kind of neighborliness that used to be there. Where you would just go to anybody's home freely and ask something, and you'd be given. Even up to today, when I visit my rural areas, there are those neighbors that mean so much to me, and I feel that I cannot come back to Nairobi before visiting them. And even maybe meeting some of their needs, or even blessing them in whichever way, because they meant so much. You know, in the rural areas, that's where people go for anything. Yeah? You don't mind, probably the things might have changed, but those days, you would fight with people calling even fire. And yet, I don't know why we never used to buy mass boxes, because they were very cheap, even less than 10 cents. Those things sometimes happen. But you would find somebody coming to your home very early in the morning to get the fire with the something for the, to carry the fire. And it would be very comfortable getting even salt and all those other things. Even pouring items. Eh? Like Christmas, you don't risk all of those pies for chapatis. Because you don't prepare them during Christmas. And you go there and find somebody is busy preparing, and you tell you, wait till I finish and then I'll give you. Eh? It's very, you know, alive of meeting the needs of other people. And compassion is all about serving others, meeting the needs of others, doing what we need to do in order to bless another person. And further, Jesus talked about, you know, meeting the needs of others. In Matthew 25, verse 34 to 46, you can write it somewhere. It's a long passage. I'll just explain what it's all about. Matthew 25, from verse 34 to 46. You note it somewhere, that would be good. But this is a very common story. But we are going to learn about serving others, neighboring well through compassion from this passage. And this passage talks of, Jesus was talking about those last days when God will gather his people. And he starts talking of, you know, how he compared it with the sheep and the goats. And he says that when God will gather his people, it will be like the way a farmer gathers his sheep and goats together. And he separates them. And he puts the goats on the left side. And he puts the sheep on the right side. And then he went further and explained and said, those who are on the right side are the righteous ones. And those who are not righteous are put on the left side. And then he continued to explain and say that those on the right side, he talks of them as those who met him when he was hungry and they gave him something to eat. And he said, there was that time he was thirsty and they gave him something to drink. He talks of a time when he was a stranger and they invited him in. And a time when he needed clothes and those on the right side, they clothed him. A time when he was sick and they looked after him. They visited him. They took care of him. And a time when he was in prison and they came to visit him. And the righteous asked, when did we do this? When did we do all these things to you? And Jesus explained, when you did this to the least of these ones, you did it for them. Praise the name of God. So whatever little acts you did to somebody to meet their needs, it's like you did it to Christ. When you hear somebody is sick and visit to that person, when you hear of somebody who is hungry and maybe you have excess with in your house and you feel touched to give, when you hear of a stranger, I thank God because in our house we many times get strangers, people that we have never known. They come and stay with us. Some may not be very good, but we still welcome them to our house. And we take care of them, some for months, others for a long time, others for a short time. And they are strangers. Some will even steal from us. But we still welcome them and welcome others. Because we know that when we do that, we are doing it like we are doing to the Lord. Because the Bible tells us to do everything like we are doing unto the Lord. When you are serving your neighbor,
Don't think that you are just serving that neighbor. You are doing it like you are doing unto the Lord. Whatever small act you do, and I tell you, they go a long way to become a blessing to the other. I was thinking of Mama Abby when Abby was sick, and she was very new in the church. In fact, I had not even known her well. And as women, we planned to go and visit her in the Kenyatta Hospital. And that is when I got to remember her very well. She was very new with us. And when we went there, she was so happy. And not only her, even those others that they were admitted together. And then we saw a bee with those heavy stones tied on her legs. And I thank God that now we see a girl who is strong and healthy and serving the Lord and blessing us in many ways. But that time, she could not even walk. And when Mama Abby gave her testimony, she remembered those days when we visited her. So those small acts that you normally do to others, they are a great blessing to others. You may think they don't mean much, but they are very, very meaningful to the others. And not only those ones that we do to, but also we do to those other people. But knowing that it goes beyond those people and it touches the heart of God and it qualifies us to become righteous. Being in prison. No, I was remembering those days when I was in was doing my studies, the degree level, and we were going to do the practicums at the committee. And you'd meet those prisoners and talk to them, counsel them. But I always remember one young man who was there, very young. And he challenged me and asked me, now that you told me you are a preacher, as I introduced myself, is there a time or in your church, do you have programs where you visit people in the prison? And that was a great challenge to me because I had not even thought of visiting anybody in the prison. Actually, I went to the prison at that time when I was doing my studies, my practicums. And later on, I thank God that after we shared about, you know, the visits to the prison, remember visiting the Rwindo prison, and we said to the people, many gave their life to Christ. We fed them. And it was a great blessing. And when our pastor in Uganda, Lord Pastor Sentabre, was jailed for 2 years, I traveled all the way to Uganda to see him in prison. Because I had that experience, I had that challenge from this young man. And when you go there, it's when you realize, you know, there are times when our mind says, all those people in prison, they have, maybe they have murdered the people, they have done that, and there are some who have done it. But I tell you, there are many innocent people who are in our prisons. So, when we do almost this, we are not just doing for those people, but we are doing it unto the Lord. So, our blessing will come from the Lord. When we clothe them, when we give out. Last year, I went to my wardrobe and Papa Sambu to give out my clothes. And I was surprised that I had so many, 2 sacks full of clothes. Some I stayed even for a year without putting on. And I was asking myself, why do I keep them? Some they are even out of fashion, and I'm still keeping them. Some are even older than my ship, and I'm still keeping them. And when I removed them, you know, I was my wardrobe was better off. And then I took them to a village called Turuma to another lady, and she distributed to the people there. And they were so happy. Even today, she keeps coming. She keeps asking me, do you still have more? And whenever I saw them out, I tell her, come for them. And they became, you know, many people are blessed in that small village. So, when you do whatever you are doing it as unto the Lord. And Jesus came to the other side and said, for those on the left side, on that side because they did not do anything to the least of his people. You know, I like that word. You know, it's emphasizing on the least. You know, at times we think of those at high things. But when we are looking at even that small one, even that child who is suffering, even that child who is helpless, when you pick that child and see the child coming up, a child who was helpless, and now you have made the life of that child change through compassion, God will come to you as having done something. See, these people are asking, when, you know, what happened? Then, you know, when did we see you hungry? And all that. And we did not visit you. When did we see you thirsty? And we did not give you. And he says, it's not me, it's when you do it to the other neighbor. So what have you done to that neighbor so that you will receive that blessing that God promises? I want to draw our attention to the book of Luke, Luke 10, verses 25 to 37. Again, the famous story of the Good Samaritan. Luke 10, 25 to 37. And we see Jesus giving a parable again about the Good Samaritan. And the Bible records three people. One of them was a priest, and this man walked along. He was the first one. And on his way, he found that man who was beaten by robbers. And the Bible records very clearly. This man saw him. So when it comes to seeing, we always see. You don't go closing your eyes. We see even the drunkards along the way. We see underneath the people because we have eyes and we open our eyes to see. This man, the priest, saw the man. And you know, many times when you see something, you always react. But now, the difference is how you react. No, the eyes see. Then in your mind, you have a feeling. Or you think. You may think, I'm going to help this person. You might feel the compassion. You feel, I cannot treat this person the way they are. I have to do something. Those are different feelings. And people may not know what you are thinking or maybe what you are feeling. What people will see is the action that you take. Towards what you see and towards the feeling that you have. Going further, a step further to do something. So, when this priest saw the man who was beaten by robbers, he saw him. The Bible does not record what he thought about him. We can only imagine. Probably he said, why did he have to travel at night so that he is beaten by robbers? Or maybe other things. But the action he took, tells us that he didn't think well about this man. What did he do? The Bible says, he crossed the other side of the road. He saw the man here, he crossed over. And do you think when he was crossing over from one side to the other, that he was not drinking something? He was. There was something that was going on in his mind. Let me say, let me receive my own, let me go my, I have my business to do. Then came the Levites. Those people who were very particular with the law, that understood the law very well. And what did this man also do? The Bible says he behaved like the first one. We can never tell what he was thinking. We don't know where he was going to. Probably the priest was going to preach, saying, I might get late. But this one, we don't know where he was going, and the Bible does not record. But he did the same. He crossed over the other side and he left the man there. But we came to the Samaritan, those people who were despised. And what did he do? He saw him, and the Bible records that he had compassion for him. Look at it. This one saw, and he crossed over the other side. The other one came and saw him, and he crossed the other side. But this third one came, and he not just moved to the other side, but he went closer to the person. Remember that time. When you met somebody in need, how did you behave? What did you do about the need of that person? Look, there are times we use the word empathy. To empathize is to feel with the person. You are feeling, you may not even have a lot to do, but you are feeling with the person. And that is what we do most in my profession of counseling. You feel with the person. You want to show the person you are really feeling with their needs. We don't sympathize, because when you sympathize, you're only telling somebody, oh, I'm so sorry for what happened. So there are people who normally do that. But when you empathize, you make another step. And this is the time when you are feeling with the person. And you have now the feelings like this other person is feeling. Maybe this good Samaritan, when he saw the man, you know, he imagined how he was beaten, how the wounds are paining. Maybe they were even bleeding that time. He felt with him. But when we talk about the compassion, it is putting the feelings and the thoughts into practice. So this man moved from empathy, feeling with the person, and moved another step of taking an action. And what did he do? Now the Bible puts it clearly. One, when he saw him, he had compassion. Then, number two, he soothed his wounds. You imagine him there, down there. He forgot about his business. At times, our business hindered us from being good neighbors, because he was not coming to take care of that man. He was going along his business, just like the priest and the Levite. But he soothed his wounds, and the Bible records that he applied olive oil to soothe the wounds and the wine. And he did not just stop there. He bandaged the man. So if he was bleeding, the bleeding stopped when he bandaged them. And then he went another step and took him and laid him or placed him on his donkey. And as if that was not enough, he did just leave him there. He went with him and then he took him to an inn. We don't know why he took him to an inn, because maybe if he's there, we'll take him to the hospital. And the times we give ourselves reason, if I find somebody who is beaten or suffering and I take him to the hospital, I will have to be asked so many questions. Am I to be implicated for having done that to the man? But this one did not care. He just took him and paid for him. And if you read the Bible clearly, it talks of he stayed with him overnight, because it talks of the following day. It's when he left him and under the care of the innkeeper. And he told him, after paying what he paid, he said, if he'd come off a I am coming to faith. You see all those steps that this man took. These are signs of compassion. In TOA, we have a compassion ministry whereby we find children who are suffering, children who are in need. I remember in 2005 when I took Dennis in and we took him to our family and he became one of us. I don't know where he would be when his relatives had given up on him, when the management in the home had given up on him. But God, through the compassion, made us take him in into our hearts. And down the line, 16 years from that time, God, we are still seeing God moving in him. Where, how does compassion move you? What do you do when you have? Let me tell you, when you have the compassion, you're not just God. You see, these two, the priest and the Levite, they went up to the level of seeing. And that is a common level for everyone. We see many times. We see people around us. You see people coming to us, working with us. The other day, the last few weeks, we have had many, many people in our compound doing some renovations. You see some people working so hard from morning to evening. As you go around, one day we told them, come with some containers, we want to give this to you. And I tell you, those people were so happy by the end of the day. And even their reaction to us has changed. Every time you go out, I always hear them saying, oh, very mama. Some are not even seeing them, maybe they are doing some work there. But you know, that respect changed from that time. And I imagine if I go to where they live and meet them, they will not pass me by. Because compassion takes you a step higher. It builds the relationship. You grow in a neighborhood. It brings another kind of love. You develop, you know, that type of relationship. When you stay with somebody, it's quite different from maybe when you are just seeing somebody from afar off. So, it is very, very important that we take action. Let not just be out there on the service. The Bible talks of going deeper. Yeah? So let's not just be on the service of seeing and turning away from the people who have needs, but turning towards their needs. And by so doing, God will bless us mightily. When you read verse 37 on the same Luke 10, no, because Jesus was giving this parable to this man who was an expert of the law. He knew the law very well. He started from the commandments. And it's like this man wanted to challenge Jesus, which is the greatest of the commandments. And Jesus explained very clearly. And then he comes to this example of the good Samaritan. And when he narrated to the expert of the law, he asked him one question. After listening to the three people, who do you think is a good neighbor? You know, he pretended he didn't know their neighbor, the meaning of a neighbor. Because he was asking Jesus, tell me who is my neighbor? And then that's when Jesus brought him the examples of those three people. But then Jesus taught him, or rather asked him, who do you think out of the three is a neighbor? And the man was right. He was an expert. Those lawyers, our learned friends, as they call themselves, they are learned, they know many things. And he asked him, which one of the three? And the man responded very well. He said, the one who showed mercy. That one who had compassion is the one who is a good neighbor. And Jesus says, you have answered well. Many times we know, we feel that That neighbor did so well, the good Samaritan. We all want to be like the good Samaritan. But Jesus, as we contributed to this man, go and do the same. Go and do like the good Samaritan. And today, Jesus is speaking to us and is telling us that good Samaritan we have admired. Let us do right. And how do we do it? By taking a step ahead of just seeing, by doing something, you know, by serving, compassionate serving, bringing a change in the life of another person. I want to talk about the 5 steps to being a good neighbor. 5 steps. One of them is that to be a good neighbor, you must be willing to get involved in issues of other people. When they need your help, you need to be that person who is willing to give the help. Because we say the good neighborliness is whereby there are those people with having needs, and there is that person who is willing to meet the needs. God expects us to be involved by taking an action. You know, people say that love or other faith without love is dead. So, even when we talk about faith, when we talk about love is about doing something. Just like this good Samaritan. He did something. He did not just pass by as many normally do, or as those two had done. And Jesus has given us a very good example in Matthew 9:36. He says, when he saw the crowds, he had compassion on them. Why? Because these people were harassed. You know, by the devil, some were harassed by the devil. They were so possessed. Some could not even see. They were harassed on their bodies, the physical, they could not see. Some were lame. Others were sinful, like the other Taras woman. They were harassed in so many ways. And when Jesus saw them, he did not close his eyes. He did not move to the other side. He met their needs. And that is why the Bible says, wherever Jesus went, what did he do? He did good. By touching those who are blind, by feeding those who are hungry, all those things he did. And why did he do that? To set a good example of us. That you must follow. Number 2. If we are to be good neighbors, we need to avoid discrimination. There is a lot of discrimination. Whereby, I only want to help my friends. I don't want to go to that old mama because we may not have a lot to talk. But maybe we don't have a lot in common. We don't want to get lower and go and visit that person. This week I was so blessed to visit the Humphreys family. I was so blessed. And you see the visit, I saw your sister's daughter there when I was in the year. She's greeting me like this. Eh? She has not known me before, but because I visited and found out then, she's very talkative and now. Very energetic. Eh? She could just wait for me. So, you see, the visit brought her closer to me. If I was to talk to her like Isaiah, you know, with her talk more. So, it is very important when you know that everybody matters in the kingdom of God. Yeah? You not just go to those people that maybe you are of the same class. The Bible says, if you do that, you have already received your reward. If you can only visit those that can visit you, if you can only give to those who can give you, then you have already received your reward. But our rewards are not other rewards. We are thinking of heavenly rewards. That are the blessing that you come. Because you see every other person as a person who needs our help. And we'll be out to help them. See this Samaritan man, the good Samaritan. You know, his name is not even mentioned. but his actions made him or qualifies him to be good. There were many other Samaritans, but this one stood out. He was good because of his actions. He didn't. Those Samaritans were despised people. He didn't even bother to find out who maybe where the robber came from or who the robber was. What he saw is that the need. And he was ready to meet that need. So we need to become like Paul, who says in 1 Corinthians 9, that I became all things to all men so as to win them for Christ. Remember, we have said whatever we do, we are doing it to bring people closer to Christ. See, like there are many people that were witnessed to during the whole foundation. Many are coming to church. Many are so happy. Yeah? You are so happy when you are talking to them. I was talking to Mrs. Maura outside there in Lodge. She's happy. She has come to our church. She never used to come here and she has, you know, a lot. And just recently, that is caring when you listen to somebody. So becoming all things to all men. Regardless of their class, regardless of whoever they are, it's very, very important. So, number three, step number three is willing to use your resources. Willing to use your resources. Some people say, you know, I cannot help because I don't have resources. Let me tell you, you have all it takes. And God will just want you to use what you have. All what God expects of us is just to take a step. And you know the problem, when we think about resources, we think of material things. But there are those people who may not have material needs, but they may meet the needs in different ways. Some just want to listen to them. They only need your time. You see, like this good Samaritan, he spent his time not taking care of this man and taking him and even spending with him some time. He used his time. He even forgot where he was going to take care of this man. So you can have that resource. Like for me, the work I normally do when I'm listening to somebody, I don't at times even give the people money. Because there may be too many. In fact, some pay me. But I listen to them. And just listening. Yesterday somebody called me, one of my clients called me and said, you know, I just want to hear your words. I just want to talk to you. Not anything else, just to talk. I told her, yes, I will talk to you. Please, you plan to sit down and talk. I will not use so much. I may not even give her anything. But just a ear. Yes? And I show that to cry up. That, maybe that's all what somebody wants. Maybe somebody just wants a visit. Just to listen to them. And they'll feel so good. So don't think that you must have so much of resources so that you can give. Look at the feeding of the 5,000. Jesus is telling his disciples, give these people food. And they are like confused. How do we give all these people? Where do we get this money to give them? And they could think about, you know, the wages. How much would we require to do all this? Jesus is telling them, give them. They're hungry. They have been with us for so long. So, you need to give them something. And what did they say? There is only one boy with the 5 loaves and 2 fish. And what did Jesus do? He got that all that they had and he multiplied it. And it was enough for all the people and still it remained. Probably you are thinking of that very little thing you have. Even the widow had very little. When Elijah asked her to prepare for her, This widow says, all what I have is going to eat with my son, and then it will be gone, and we wait to die because there was famine. He says, the servant of God says, prepare for that for me. And the widow obeyed. And when she gave it to the man of God, he multiplied the little that she had. Probably that little we hold prevents us from greater blessings. Sometimes it may be painful to give, but when we give, we receive God's blessing. I'm thinking of how we left our house in Kinago, and we left it to the orphans. We just started the compassion ministry. And we came to Nairobi, and we had to rent a house for many years. And just waiting on God, He gave us maybe 3 or more times than that one. And even up to today, it has always served with those people in Kenya. Right now, that is where Samuel and Rose are staying, in that same house. We have never even asked for any rent for that house. But it has served so, so many people. And in return, God has given us a big one. The other day, Bishop was asking me, well, can we just go and build a smaller one on that other side, and then we can rent this big one? Can you imagine? In the compound. Because, you know, the word of God is very true. It says, whatever we sow, we will. When we give, He will give us more and more. Heal, it will fill, and then run over. Have you seen God blessing you? Till you see the blessings running over. Have you been blessed till you feel you are overwhelmed by God's goodness? Because God expects us to use the resources that we have. And God will not ask you to give more than. Number 4. Good neighborliness requires one to be trustworthy. Being trusted. And you see now, trustworthy comes again with the sharing of what you have. Can you be trusted? Can God trust you in the first place? He has given you that salary. He has given you that business. Can He trust you that you can share that? That you can give back to God? That you can give that other person who is lacking. Are you trustworthy enough that even people can count on you? See this good Samaritan. He leaves the man in the inn and says, I'll pay this amount, but if he uses more, I'll come back and pay. And the owner allows him to go because he's a trustworthy man. He knows he'll go and come back and pay. Probably he was a customer there. But a trustworthy customer. So, in our neighborliness, we need to be good neighbors. And finally, we need to express generosity. Giving out. Generosity is the quality of being kind and generous. That quality of being kind. Are you kind? Are you giving out? Are you compassionate? Are you expressing it? Are you expressing that generosity? You see, we looked at the resources and we have said God has given us many things, different kind of things. But are we willing to give out? You know, that is when we express generosity. So it goes along with the action that we talked about, when, like this good Samaritan, seeing that man, he expresses it by giving out, paying for him in the inn, with all those other things. To help, to get this man out of the problem. That is expressing generosity, using the resources taking up a second mile to help another person. It's all about her compassion. Finally, as I conclude the so that nobody challenges to take actions, not just the hearers of the word, just as Jesus Christ laid down his life for us.
This is how we know what love is. Jesus Christ laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our life for our friends. If anyone has material possession and sees his brother in need, but has no pity on him, how can the love of God be in him? Dear children, let us not love with words or tongue, but with actions and deeds.
Amen. Amen. Let us not just laugh with words, but with action. May God help us. Father, we thank you for speaking to us today. We pray that you will help us to express that compassion that you have put in us. The Lord will just be doers of your word by having compassion over the others, O God. We pray that Jehovah, we will not be like those two men who just saw the person they made suffering and bleeding and did not take any action. Instead, they moved to the other side. Lord, I pray that each one of us will be a good neighbor to one another by meeting the needs of each other. May you help us, our Father. We pray that you will bless us in the coming week, that we continue to learn how to be good neighbors to one another. We pray, we bless you, and we pray that your blessings will continue to flow in our lives throughout the week. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God bless you. Have a wonderful week.